Noon in Moscow right now, specifically shortly after 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And about an hour ago, anti-Yeltsin demonstrators stormed the, broke through the blockade of the parliament building, where lawmakers have been holed up for about 11 days now. The parliament building in the square, nearby the mayor's office, the demonstrators also a short while ago told by their leadership to storm the mayor's office. And also in this same area, CNN's bureau, and atop the bureau, our chief, Steve Hurst.
Ralph, while we were in that commercial break, there was sporadic gunfire again. Just as we went into the break, we could see pictures of people from this vantage point running up that ramp near the Mir Hotel, the Peace Hotel. It sits just behind the mayor's office, between the mayor's office and the United States Embassy compound. There was that running again, and we heard sporadic gunfire. It has now stopped again. These people have been ordered, as you heard earlier, by Alexander Rutskoy, the Assad vice president, and then that was backed up by Ruslan Hasbulatov, the chairman of this banned parliament inside the White House, to attack the mayor's office, also to attack across town at the Russian Broadcasting Center. Picture now of troops in flak jackets. This is looking across the bridge from our vantage point on the roof of the CNN bureau.
Steve, they are wearing flak jackets, as you point out, but we haven't seen any indication yet, have we, that the demonstrators are armed?
Yes, the demonstrators, some of them are armed, Ralph. When this, when the crowd first made its way across the barricades into the White House grounds, you know, the initial fighting broke out. Many armed men were seen running out of the White House carrying Kalashnikovs. We have reports of between 800 to 1,500 weapons that were inside of that building at the disposal of an unknown number of mercenary soldiers and volunteers who have been in and around the White House since this crisis first began, and since Mr. Hasbulatov and Mr. Rutskoy first began whipping up fears that the Yeltsin forces would try more gunfire. A lot more gunfire going on now. Crowd dispersing at least momentarily. That hail of gunfire, we don't know if it was fired at people or into the air yet again. Very effective, though, at moving these people back a bit.
We saw during that gunfire, see, we could just see here people going down, but it appeared that rather than being shot, that they were simply ducking.
Yeah, I think that probably we're still at the point where we see the soldiers are under order to fire into the air to try to stop the crowd. No indication yet that they're firing on people.
There's more gunfire.
It won't be too much longer now. It's after 4 in the afternoon. It won't be too much longer before we see the end of light in Moscow and darkness begin to fall. I would think that would create the potential for even more problems, would it not?
Well, certainly it's going to complicate the situation. We have about an hour and a half, 2 hours of daylight left. The sun is about 30 degrees above the horizon right now. It's been a beautiful fall day in Moscow, and that probably accounts somewhat for the size of this demonstration, because until now, these demonstrators had faced, even last week, a very, very early snowstorm overnight during one tense period. We heard gunfire earlier, but they certainly have coming to nightfall is going to complicate the situation. I would suspect
that any retaliation by the Yeltsin forces
is going to wait until nightfall to cover in darkness. I think probably it's going to take them a while to get themselves organized now, because there seems to be a great deal of disarray on the side of Yeltsin forces.
Certainly the Interior Ministry troops with their shields and batons were unable to stop this crowd of 5,000 or so people.
Back looking at the front of the mayor's office
from my vantage point.
Steve, I would like to do a recap for the benefit of people who have just joined us over the past couple of minutes. A little over an hour ago, demonstrators who are opposed to Boris Yeltsin's reforms stormed through the blockade of the Parliament building. That is the building also known as the White House, where lawmakers had been holed up inside for about 11 days now. Warning shots were fired over the heads of the demonstrators by riot police. And we're going to show you what that looked like about 45 minutes ago. Let's listen.
Earlier, the riot police firing, we believe, over the heads of the demonstrators. Steve, I would think that there would be two possible outcomes if the police were to fire at the demonstrators and if anyone were shot and killed or wounded. One would be that the demonstrators would be scared and leave the area. The other would be that they would be so angry that they would really take things into their own hands and put into effect the orders that they had a little while ago and storm the mayor's office.
Well, Ralph, one hates to make any sort of predictions, but the pictures you see now show people who are determined in their mission. A relatively small number of people, as I said, there's 5,000 to 10,000 people out of a city of 9 million doing all of this, bringing the world's attention to a potentially barely violent scene outside the Russian White House and the mayor's building, virtually in the shadow of the American embassy. They seem determined. And I think this determination is going to hold in the short run. That picture now from our White House camera.
The men who apparently have commandeered an armored personnel carrier over in the neighborhood
of the Peace Hotel, and now they're pushing a water truck out of the way. That APC seems clearly to be in the hands of the demonstrators. These paramilitary groups interspersed among the demonstrators and defending the White House. You hear the applause as this armored personnel carrier with his big gun on the front pushed that water truck out of its way, apparently going back towards the White House. You can hear more gunfire now in the background.
People are ducking behind trucks now.
More firing. Steve, does most of the activity seem to be moving from the White House toward the mayor's office?
It's,
here we can see an APC with its the front of it on fire, roaring down the street from our vantage point behind the Russian White House.
It wasn't stopped at a fire truck with a water cannon on it. A firefighter is getting prepared to try to put out that fire on that armored personnel carrier.
Ralph, it's difficult to say where all of the people are moving. There's total pandemonium down there. I don't know if that's too strong a word.
Many thousands appeared to move for a while towards the mayor's office. There's still a group of people behind right up. More people running as gunfire was fired.
Our people on the ground where this picture you see now say there were shots fired there.
New Arbat Street, just across the bridge on the Moscow River here.
The view from our vantage point on the roof of the CNN Bureau. It very much seems off its point as if the demonstrators, the paramilitary groups that are mixed in with the demonstrators, are also mixed in with riot police. That appears now to be a group of policemen moving back towards where we heard those gunshots fired. Extraordinarily fluid situation.
And I think it's worth repeating here, Steve, that considering what has been going on in this area, considering the numbers of people, considering the fact that they were so fired up by Rutskoy and Kozbolotov about 45 minutes ago, that so far as we have been able to see, there have been no casualties.
Excuse me, Ralph, I lost audio for just a second. I'm back with you. I think you were saying, as I lost my audio, that it's rather extraordinary that we haven't seen at least more evidence of overt violence, and I think that you're right so far. I think it shows, at least at this point, some fairly strong restraint on the part of the Interior Ministry, which is
could overwhelm these people with its arms.
Steve, we're going to continue our live coverage from Moscow. We will be back with you in just a moment, right after we take this short break. We'll be back. live coverage from Moscow, and as our correspondent and bureau chief there, Steve Hurst, has been reporting, the demonstrators who have been on the streets of Moscow now for well over an hour.